Good afternoon. Welcome to our concert of praise. What number is this, Carol? Our fourth concert of praise. We're certainly glad for your presence with us this afternoon. We're glad you made it out on this lovely afternoon. But just to let you know, I normally sit over there, but first of all, they took up the, and then they got a cake over there. I don't know what that's about. They're afraid I would get into the cake, so I had to come over here. But we also will be enjoying the light supper afterwards, chicken dinner kind of thing. So make sure you go downstairs and partake of that afterwards. And we'll have a reminder of that as well. Well, I'm Paul Anderson. I'm the pastor here at First Presbyterian Church of Merrillville. I'm also the pastor of Dyer Presbyterian Church. And I'm a dear friend of Bishop Larry Shaver, who is unfortunately unable to be with us today, but Carol is the inspiration behind it. And we're very glad to be able to participate, and with all who've come out to be with us today. So thank you very, very much. Let's begin with the word. Oh, gracious God, we do give you thanks for the opportunity we have together to sing your praise. We recognize that as we offer up our song, our praise, that we do so with the sure knowledge that you receive our prayers and blessing and praise and return it to us as your faithful men and women. Bless our time together. May what we do and say bring honor and glory to our Christ, who is Savior of the world. And in whose name we pray. Amen.
Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing.
Rejoice, rejoice, how can I say? to Matthew 28, when Jesus said to the disciples, "Unto me all authority in heaven and earth has been given. Therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit." And that's where we get the word Trinity, which means, obviously, three. So my helper, Emily, is going to show us our chart here. And actually, this is really misleading. But we have one person, God person, this God the Father, who's created everything that we know of. His blessed Son, Jesus, given to save us. He's our Savior. And then the Holy Spirit, which is come as an advocate and sustainer for us. We have three persons working on our behalf, distinct persons. And this is misleading because we think about God being the president and Jesus being the vice president and the Holy Spirit being the secretary of church. That is the way it is. It's linear. They're all the same. They're equal. They work together. One example I can give you is, I'm a mother, I'm a mother, I'm a grandmother, and I'm also an educator. So those are my three attributes, and they can kind of blend in and fit and move in with each other, but those are three things that one person is. Let's take Brother Paul, for example. Okay, he's a father, he's a grandfather, and he's a pastor. And he doesn't walk around with a sign that divides him in thirds. He's all those things. One person with three very profound attributes. And to share with you, so like I said, this is customarily what we see, a triangle, but it should be linear. And to share with you the power of the Holy Spirit, several years ago in our parish, we had a very devout Christian lady. Her husband, at best, was an agnostic, but he was an architect. And so he was asked to build our church, St. Andrew Anglican Church, to have the concept and the structure, the architecture of our church. So he was working one day in his studio, and he called his wife and he says, "Margo, I keep getting this feeling there's something special about three." So she began to tell him just how special those three were, although he had no idea. And now our church has three gables, the bottom, the middle, and the spire, which is always reaching for his head and God above. So it's a wonderful power that's working in our lives, and perhaps I'm liking just a little bit on who these three person gods are in our life. Given to us to help us lead our Christian faith. And in this broken and fragmented world, we need all the help we can get. Right? Amen. Let's stand in honor of these people with the doxology.
Play for me today. But I'm going to give a song that's very, very special to my mom and I. It's called Finally Home. And I sang this, I'm going to cry, at my dad's funeral. And my mom played for me. And they were married for 66 years. And I would love to share this song with y'all.
Swedish. immigrants. And I liked being Swedish, and he, well, he was all right with it, of course, and he loved it, but he loved his heritage, but he didn't really do much with it. So I tried to. Well, then, just coincidentally, I became a pastor in the Svenska Missionsförbundet Kyrka. That's a Swedish Mission Covenant Church. And now it's called the Evangelical Covenant Church. But so they had some of that Swedish stuff, and it was kind of cool. But then my son really took hold of it. So he corrected me. I think I'm going to get it kind of right, but, you know, of course he says I don't get it right. But that's what sons are supposed to do with their fathers. So the song I'm going to sing is He the Pearly Gates Will Open. Anybody know that hymn? He the Pearly Gates Will Open? Good for you. It's a wonderful little song. One thing about Swedish hymnody, especially in this kind of Swedish, they come out of the Lutheran tradition. Maybe Lutheran here? Okay, well, I'm going to say anything too bad. But, they like German hymns like that, you know. And these are Swedish as a little teen, and it's always about the heart of Jesus. And precious, and if you look in the lyrics, they'll say, coming from the heart of Jesus. The precious love of Jesus. And it's always about that kind of heart, loving Jesus from our heart, that kind of thing. And, well, everybody does it, but it's been kind of in that reference of real strong, firm conviction, but also this being in love with Jesus. And that's kind of what it's about. And that's the basis of a lot of Swedish hymnody. And this is just kind of a fun song. It was actually written in Chicago. The big Swedish migration into Chicago, Frederick Bloom was there in 1917. Well, then it got published in 1924 in the, let me get this right, Frelsningen Armenien. That's the Swedish for Salvation Army. And my grandparents actually met at the Salvation Army in Chicago. They're both from Sweden, but they met in Chicago. And they got married, of course. And from that experience. And then my father was born in 1924. And he taught us, so my siblings and I, we would sing the chorus to this song. And it's the way you say it in Swedish is An her upna, perli porten, he the pearly gates will open. Her upna, perli porten. And so what we're going to do, I'm going to sing the first verse in Swedish. And I've been told I sing good in Swedish. No one ever told me that in English, but in Swedish they said it's good. And then I'm going to invite you to sing the verse with me in Swedish. I'm sorry, in English. Right, so I'll do it in Swedish. We'll do it together in English. Then the second verse, which is just long. Just long. I should say, yeah, well, I'll sing in Swedish, and then we'll sing it in English. Okay, and thankful for Cheryl to accompany at this. Okay, now I can get my cheat sheet out here. Sunny, so may it.
songs in that bulletin are reversed. I'll be doing Shall We Gather at the River first, and then directly into this little letter.
Thank you. fell in love with the lyrics and syncopation, but when you, the music of syncopation, but when you look at the words to the song, I just wanted to take a minute to kind of share that with you. Because this is a song where the first two stanzas kind of, it's the invitation to the Lord's Supper. The third is, so it's, come, let us eat, for now the feast is spread. Our Lord's body let us take together. Then it goes into, come, let us drink, for now the wine is poured. The third stanza then kind of sets the mood. It's the whole meditation, the piece of, in Jesus' presence, now we meet and rest. In the presence of our Lord, we gather. And finally, the last piece is the big reminder to go out and spread God's word. So the verse for that is, rise then to spread abroad God's mighty word. Jesus risen will bring on the living word. So join us, but come let us. So, here we go. Now we'd like to invite all of you. So it's a beautiful sound earlier, so here we go. God be, what's it, let me get it.
Thank you. ourselves. We didn't bring all the tables this time.
Thank you.
just graduated from high school, and she's running in the walk, and we are loving grace.
We're so thankful for everybody coming out, and don't forget we have food downstairs. So I'm going to include a blessing for the food, and then a blessing for us leaving. Let's pray. Oh, gracious God, we do give you thanks for the way that you provide for our needs, but especially we're thankful that as we gather here this day, we celebrate the gift of fellowship that goes across our church boundaries, and that we can join together because we are brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ. And we're thankful that we can sing the praises of God in our various ways, but nevertheless, all to your glory. We're thankful for the blessing of this time we have together. Now bless our time together as we gather to around the table to partake of fellowship and food. Thankful for the food we're about to receive. And now as we go forth from this place, may we go with the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.